My name is Jason Harwig. I'm a developer on Chris's team working on Lumify, and I'm going to talk about Twitter Flight, which is the predominant UI framework we use for Lumify. So it's a web framework written in JavaScript, created by Twitter. So they released it this year in January, and it's at version 1.1.1. MIT licensed. It's a component-based event framework, and we'll talk about all those things. Components are kind of an overloaded term, but think about just objects on the page that are kind of decoupled from each other for reusability. It's a very small library. There's not a lot to it. The component.js file is most of the project, and the rest is debug and utility classes. So it's pretty small, 1,200 lines. 9K gzipped and modern browser support, back to IE7 even so. Here's what you get when you download it. It's just a couple JS files and some testing utilities and markdown docs. So like I said, it's pretty small, so it's easy to learn and it's easy to integrate in other projects where you're maybe doing a lot. It fits in pretty much any situation. Chris has given me a very weird smile. So,
it's the jacket.
Well, when you're a UI guy, you have to really dress up. So you wouldn't know that, Chris.
Did you shower today?
Does it matter if I showered or not? Yeah, probably. David was there. I'm staying with David. Well, I'm in town from Milwaukee. That's where I live. So Twitter Flight requires jQuery or something that is similar, like Zepto is a modern library that simulates the API. So if you're not using jQuery or anything similar, you'll have to add that to add Twitter Flight, so it might not be the best fit for that kind of project. Also, ES5 shim, it stands for ECMAScript 5 shim, so older browsers like IE7 don't support some of the JavaScript functions like array.foreach and filter and all of those. So that just fills in, so all the browsers are kind of up to the modern level, and they write to that. And recommended is AMD, which is asynchronous module definitions in JavaScript. You don't have to use an AMD format, and we'll talk about that next slide, but you can also use it standalone just by importing the Twitter Flight and just like any other JavaScript. But really recommended, it really fits the component model well to use these modules. So let's talk about one implementation of AMD is require.js. And so the idea is that you separate these components, or really whatever, some kind of physical entity that does something into these different files. So defining is actually, you do that to define your component. And you can optionally give it a name, but if you don't, which we're not giving it any name here, it just uses the path of the actual file. So we're defining videoplayer.js, really. The first parameter is an array of all dependencies that component requires. This is just nothing, so we're just going to move on and assuming that we implemented some kind of video player and then return it. And so that's the basic creating a module in AMD. And require.js is one of them. There's a whole bunch of others. I think there's an AMD.js. That all of their APIs are the same. The AMD standard defines the API. So then if you want to use the video player in another component, you just say require. And this could be anywhere in that page.js I just put there. It doesn't have to be at the top. It can be within a function that is executed when the user clicks something. And the nice thing about that is it's not actually going to download that video player JavaScript until they actually click that button. So you get nice performance because you only need to load the things that the user actually needs right then. And require.js also has an optimizer. So if you really want to just cram everything into one file and send that one thing, because you're going to use every module on the page, you can also make an optimization step that automatically combines them. So when you're requiring, similar to above, you pass an array of all the dependencies that thing needs, and they'll be passed in to your callback function. So the callback function obviously won't be called until everyone is loaded. And so you could have layers of these where a couple things are loaded at the same time and then load some more things later depending on user action. And AMD is, so normally when you require a JavaScript file, you say script source, and it loads it, actually stops the browser from executing. So the benefit of using an AMD framework is that the page renders, and then JavaScript can come in over time, and multiple at the same time, too. The browser will do a pipeline and download 4 files at once, or whatever the browser sets as its limit. So it's a lot, actually, faster than just using script source tags. So that's required.js, and this has nothing to do with Flyte, except we're going to be using this for all our examples and defining components. So what is Twitter Flyte? I already mentioned it's a component-based framework, so really it's all centered around components. And all a component is some behavior around a DOM element, so a div or a table or a button even. It could be the granularity that you pick for your element really just varies on how much behavior there is and how you want to abstract it and split up these different functionalities. So let's make a component using the same required.js. So every component requires on this flytlib component file, so we just require that. And all that does is wrap a constructor that we create for our component with a couple methods. So this is the simplest thing where Twitterflyte uses in other examples, is returning the wrapped component and then defining it afterwards, which might look weird in some top to bottom parsing languages, but JavaScript promotes all functions to the top of that function. So simple will be available before it's really defined in the line, but it simplifies and everyone just kind of uses this standard. So it might look weird, but that's how it works. So we're just calling that component function that we get from the dependency, and it wraps our constructor. And then when we want to use that file, I'm not showing it here, but we would require our component, just like on the other slide, and then we would attach it to a DOM node. So here we're attaching it to a div. You could pass in jQuery elements here, or an actual DOM element node. And it can take more than one, so this selector might match multiple divs on the page. It would be creating an instance for each one of those divs, which is sometimes what you want, sometimes not. So you can be more specific to that. Then there's also a class level teardown all, which will actually tear down all the components of that name. And there's a teardown that we'll see later too, that if you're in an instance, you can tear down just that one instance of the component. So that's the basic model of a component. This is actual flight code from the component. When we actually attach, you can see that it's just looping through the selector, and we'll go into the registry later, but the DOM node already has that component attached, it just returns, so it doesn't reattach the same component to the node twice. But you can see all it's really doing is saying, hey, new this, that's creating a new instance of your component, and calling initialize on that, which just sets up a couple things for the component to launch. So what is the lifecycle? There's really two events for components, initialize and teardown. And so inside of your simple constructor, you could have stuff like this that happens after the node is initialized. So here we're saying after initialization, call this.node.html rendered. So Flyte, the node that you attach to, so some div in our previous example, would be a reference to this.node. And you can see that the dollar sign means it's a jQuery object. You can also call this.node without the dollar sign, and you get the DOM element. So you can use either one depending on if you want to call jQuery methods or just raw DOM manipulation. So we're using the jQuery HTML method to just put some text in this div. And then we're listening for a close event, and we'll tear down the thing. And then after teardown, we do some other cleanup. So there's nothing in Flyte that has that you have to have any kind of UI or you have to remove nodes. It's the component could be attached to HTML that was rendered on the server. So it could have like a whole structure of what that component should be, and you're just applying to that. You could also have the component render its DOM structure. It just depends on what you want to do. So in this case, we're removing the node that was attached. So that's not always what you do, but you have the opportunity to do it on teardown. So, and we'll talk about this syntax later, coming soon. But the other thing a component can have is attributes. So when you're attaching to a DOM element, you can also pass in options or attributes. And the component itself defines some default ones. And here we're defining some selectors. So this is what the component will use when it's trying to manipulate its internal structure. And since these can be overridden, you could have a component and say, oh, don't act with OLs and LIs, act with a UL, an unordered list, instead of so you can configure how the component works without it really caring or knowing. And so if you define those selectors, so we had list selector and list item selector. So if you want, when you're inside the component and you want to do something with those selectors, you call this.select and then that name that was the key in the map. And so that's equivalent to this.node.findOL, because it actually just passes that string into the find command. So that could be OL dot a class name, or it could be multiple things. It's just a CSS selector to get at a certain element, which makes it powerful because you can change that when you create the instance. And so if you have multiple components on a screen, how do they talk to each other? Normally you just call methods and say, update, here's some data to update, but flight is strictly events. Everything is decoupled so that you can just rip it out and put it somewhere else. As long as it's getting the same events, it'll react the same way. So it really makes it all of these components reusable and pretty nice. So this is all just built on top of jQuery's events. So if you want to trigger an event from your component, you call this.trigger. You can pass in a node that you want it to trigger on specifically. If you don't, it'll trigger on the attached to node, so the this.node object. Your event name, which can be anything, or it could be a DOM event like click. And then data object, which is just a plain JavaScript object of whatever data you want to pass around. When you want to listen, you just, in your initialization method, you would call this to kind of register what you're interested in, what events do you want to pay attention to. And it works the same way. You pass in on what actual object you want to listen to with events. By default, it's the node that it was attached to, and an event name and the callback that gets called. So like I said, that event name could be anything. So you really want to step back and look at your application and what events make sense for that. So in Lumify, when you select a vertex on the graph, that's a vertices selected event, and it's an array of all the vertices that were selected that are passed into that data object. So it's really up to you to define those events and the event contracts between components. And the nice thing about events is multiple things can react to that change instead of calling methods on. It's kind of like what all basic UI frameworks do is move to event-based messaging. So when you're using events, you really need to understand the DOM bubbling, which Twitter Flight relies on for all event handling. So this is just a review. If you imagine a page and a button, or here in a list element, we're going to click it. So there's two phases that the DOM goes through, an event capturing phase and an event bubbling phase. So what happens when you click on that LI, the browser sends click events to everything before that. So it's called we're in the capture phase right now. So the window will get a click event in the capture phase, the document, the body, the UL, the LI in this case. They'll all get click events. And then it switches from the capture phase, which is not really supported to react to in most cases, to the bubbling phase, which is what most people use. And that's where the LI looks like it's the first thing that gets the event, because it goes through the capture phase, and then the click is registered on the LI, and then it goes back all the way to the window. So LI gets a click, And then UI gets a click event, and body gets a click event, so on, all the way up. But at any time, you can call event stop propagation, and it'll stop that flow. So if I just want to respond to the LI click, and I don't want the UL or the body or the window to react to it, I can stop it. And so that comes in handy with custom events. You can control the flow of these events throughout your document model. And so I said Twitterflight doesn't have any templates or rendering. It also doesn't have routing or data stores. It's really just components and events. But you can use templates to have your components render things. Here's a request, and this is all just using require.js. There's really nothing specific to Twitterflight here. In your require.js configuration, you just specify some plugin, and require.js has this special syntax. You can see it's TPL, bang, and then a path. Here we're using .slash to get a relative path that really doesn't have anything to do with the plugin. So that TPL bang means it's a plugin that'll download not just JavaScript, but something else. So this is actually using a text plugin. So you can, which is kind of nice, you can download templates when you actually need them, just like JavaScript. There's also require.js plugins for images. So you could have some code that downloaded an image or any kind of resource, really. So, and then here we're just using the template to render the node content. So it's very flexible because you just, whatever templating system you want to use, here we're using Mustache. Lumify uses EJS. You can use, it just plugs in whatever you want to use. So here's the Twitterflight example application. Here it is working. And so you can change folders, and the mail items on the right change with those contents. You can select a mail item, and you notice that the toolbar is disabled unless you have a selection. So there's a lot of interactivity going on here and you could write this with using one page and just calling methods and using jQuery to update things. But these are all just using events. And we'll show an example of some of that. So here, I've actually taken that component and put it into here. Spoiler, this is also a Twitterflight app, this whole presentation app. So I just dragged the component JS file and a template of that toolbar. I don't have the stylings. There's no CSS in Flight. If you import it and change it, then it's whatever you want. But so here I have two buttons. And down here I have a log of the events that are happening. So this button here sends a UI mail item selection changed with some IDs. And that Flight example app toolbar just listens for that and enables itself once there's a selection. So if I select nothing now, passing in an empty array, it disables itself. So I haven't changed anything about that component. I'm just sending events that it is expecting, and it's working in a different environment. So it kind of shows the reusability of components. So someone could make a toolbar component, and you could pass in the buttons that you wanted and the events that they triggered, and you're not really writing any code to make that toolbar. So here's the actual component for that. A lot of this is familiar. There's selectors for all the different buttons in that toolbar. The component doesn't do any rendering. It's all just in the static HTML page of what buttons are there, and it just adds a behavior. You can see after we initialize, we are listening for click events, and each of those selectors, this is using jQuery's event delegation to map a selector to an action. And I don't have these methods in this file. They were just, all these methods do is trigger an event with that name. So this dot delete mail, and I'll go back to here. So if I click delete, all it's doing is triggering a delete mail with no data. So it doesn't really have any smarts at all. It's just triggering events, what happens. So we'll talk about more, what actually is doing stuff, because something has to. We'll talk about that a little later. Here's the other event, or the other component. The folders on the left. So you can see as I click, it's requesting mail items for that folder and then sending a, hey, I changed folders to this index. So if the toolbar is just sending those events, hey, delete, what is actually making things happen? Well, components don't have to have any kind of UI associated with them, they can be attached to the document node. And so in that way, they're going to receive every event that bubbled up to the document. So they can make decisions and send new events based on those. So for example, Lumify, every time we trigger an event to add something to the graph, it bubbles up to the document data store component, which then does AJAX, gets results back, and pushes events back up, fires another event on the document, hey, vertices are updated. And all the other components just listen for that event on the document and then can update themselves. So that's what the mail app's doing. It has a data store on the document that just reacts to all those delete mail messages. It knows what selection selected because it also listens for selection events. So it knows what actions to do on what data. Flight storage uses local storage or a couple other storage techniques in the browser to automatically persist things. So you can bubble up save events from a component and it would automatically save them. It's a third party component. You could think of other things like a clipboard or an undo manager that could react to document level events and act accordingly. So here's Lumify. So just some of the events that happened, you can see we've selected, and it doesn't matter where we make a selection in the search results or in the graph, it propagates a selected event, which then affects search. It selects it in the search pane. It also brings up the detail pane, which is just listening for selection events. So that all happens without either one of those telling the other to select this event. So it's just one event that everyone's listening to. And so if you have to kind of decide what is a component, at what granularity you would have. So here's GitHub, just using it as an example for kind of working through what would we make a component, and just the first run, maybe all of these would be their own component and they can update themselves and listen for events. But you might see that the file browser is kind of a too large of a component, so you could break it up and make each one of those like a file directory line. And just one call could attach it to all of those nodes if you use the right selector with attached to. So you can see how it's really up to you on how granular your components could be. Each, just the doc clicked image could be a component if it had enough functionality with it. Maybe there's a pop-up menu that did stuff, and then you could all just have that in one place. You don't have this monolithic file browser component. So another example is this presentation app, which is written in Twitter Flight. And here's some of the components that I'm using. The slide list on the left, actually each one of those elements in the slide list is a slide editor, which is this whole thing. So it's just reusing the same component across those two. I'm just using CSS transforms to scale it to get it pretty. The slide editor toolbar at the top. So it listens for element selected events. All of these things are elements. So if I click on one that can actually, like a text one, I can see I got new commands for what I can do with it because it's listening for elements that are selected. I can change the highlighting to HTML, which it doesn't recognize. And so this toolbar is sending tool selected events, which the slide editor then listens to and changes it. So you can see the highlighting changed when I switch to HTML. And so they're all decoupled. I could remove the toolbar, nothing breaks. I just lose that functionality. I could put the toolbar somewhere else with it in a different app as long as I sent those same events. So, and the configuration for the slide editor in the attached to of the two different versions I passed to allow edit, which just makes me not be able to edit things small in the little slide list. And here's some of the code that I use for that. You can see I actually have a split pane component to get the two split panes, the slide list, the slide editor toolbar, and then all the elements are individual components. There's a code display, text display, an image, and the logger, which gave us our events messaging. And they share some code with elements at the bottom, which we'll get to soon. So you can download third-party components. Since these are reusable, you can publish them and just bring them into your project. This is a website that you can search on to install them. You can search for flight, because they're all of them are prefixed with flight dash, so that'll bring up all of them. And then just use Bower, which is a dependency management for JavaScript, to bring it in, just like NPM or Gem. So when we had the we created our component, we had this dot before or after initialize and this dot after teardown. So those are all aspect-oriented programming calls, kind of putting code before and after methods and even wrapping a method. So Twitter flight adds these things to your component. So you pass in the name of the method. So initialize is an actual method. That's how we're wrapping it. But it could be your own methods. So here's an example of the stuff before initialize. You actually get, so you remember before we actually used after initialize. That's when your node is ready. But before, you can change the configuration parameters that we're in attached to if you wanted to. This dot after teardown, you could clean up. So this dot around is wrapping the original function. So imagine we had a select folder function in our component. We pass a callback. The first parameter is the original select folder method. And then the rest of the parameters are the original arguments. So here we kind of make a cross-cutting concern of security with our select folder action, which we ask this other method, hey, does the current user have access to this folder? If they do, we just call that function. That'll be like pass through to select folder. Otherwise, we may show a dialogue or anything like that. But the nice thing is, this isn't in your, it is in, not in your select folder method, so you can kind of get that stuff out of there. So mixins, another nice feature. You saw the with elements mixin. The mail app uses with select to handle selection between folders and mail items, because it's basically the same, similar kind of code. You're looking for click events, changing the highlighted state, sending a selected trigger event. So in the example mail app, they include this with select. And the way you do that is when you define your component with that requirement that you brought down, you just add extra parameters to your constructor. So in our first example, mail items or folders was simple, the simple component. You just can keep passing mixins to add to that component. So here is the folders component for the mail app. We require the with select mixin along with the flight component, and we just pass that to the component initialization. So you'll see that this component listens on UI folder selection changed, but it never triggers it anywhere. It's actually triggered from with select, and so this just listens to it. And here is the actual mixin. We don't have to require anything because it's just a function that's going to add to our function. So the inside of the with select looks similar to what a component would do, and it's just adding extra things to do. So it's adding default attributes and adding an after initialize block, and then listening for click events and sending that UI folder selection changed, which is actually an attribute that was passed in so it can be used in multiple components. So testing, because these are kind of decoupled and just using events, it's pretty easy to test these things if you write them right. On Lumify, we use Mocha as our testing framework. The example uses Jasmine, but they're almost identical in their syntax anyways. So here is a test for folders. describe component before each and it are all part of the testing framework. Twitter Flyte gives you setup component, which just creates your component based on that path. It loads it in and initializes it and creates a DOM element for it and attaches to it. So you can create your tests that check for events that are triggered, trigger events, and then see if an event was triggered, and just make sure your component works. So, it comes with, Twitter Flyte comes with Karma, which is a great test runner. I'm going to run a couple examples here. So Karma start single run. So what it actually did was launch Firefox and Chrome, and you can configure it to whatever browsers you have installed. It runs the test and then exits and gives you an exit code. So it's a pretty cool, it's not like Selenium, it's just running that unit test in the browser. So the nice thing is you're getting a real browser and multiple different browsers, possibly from different platforms, all running your tests at the same time and reporting back the answer. So you can, if you don't have any browsers installed or you're on a headless machine, you can use PhantomJS and it just runs all the tests like that. Maybe. I'm just going to exit that. Usually works. And then it also has a watching command, so you can start and then it just waits for any changes on the file system. So if I were to change the expected folders to 3, I can see that it failed. Matt, you want to connect? These browsers don't have to be on any single system, so Matt just connected with Safari on the Mac. If this works, I can connect my phone, and so you can have mobile devices running your tests. This is all just a side kind of thing. It's not really Twitter Flyte, but Karma is pretty cool because so you can test in all these target platforms. So some tips for writing components. Avoid AJAX calls within your component. The problem is you can mock AJAX in your tests, but it's kind of difficult. And then reusing that component becomes difficult too because you're relying on a server component. So the best thing to do is actually make, so you have to read it kind of bottom to top, but you have to write it this way. You trigger a request documents or whatever you're looking for, and that goes up the bubbles up, and then somewhere else is listening on that, does that AJAX request, and then sends the document requested with the results. That's why it's really easy to test, and it's also really easy to move that to some other project, and maybe you'd even abstract those event names to something, request data or something. So that's a good tip. We have to change Lumify to do that. So this.on and this.off, Twitter Flyte handles all removing of those events when a component is torn down. But if you use like this.node.on or this.select and then .on, Twitter Flyte can't monitor all those and remove them. So just use the ones provided by Flyte. Don't jump down to jQuery to add events. This is the mail app example. Don't use IDs in your selectors, then you can't move this to another part of the page because you'll get weird results with selectors because you're only supposed to have one ID on the page. So once you create a component and you want to release it, you can do it pretty easily. There's a generator project in the Flyte repo that can generate you a component, and you can just use Grunt to release it, and then it'll show up in Bower search after that. Now, so I said that you should only use events to communicate with things. There is a way to get an instance of a component from a node, and it's with the Flyte registry. You probably shouldn't use it very often, but there is cases where you might want to tear down everything that's attached to this node, and so you want to get at all the instances from a certain DOM node, so you can do that. just by requiring the flightlib registry. There's a logger, so at any time you could open up a console and say debug.enable, and then specify what events you want to log, because there could be a lot of them. So you could log all things that will log every time a component registers for an event, so any on calls, any off calls. You could also say just log by action trigger, so any kind of fire event you'll see. So you can, and you can do that anytime when the app's running, or just have debug always enable that in your code. The easiest way to try Flyte is just use their app generator, just using YoYoMan, and just do this. YoYoMan. Y-E-O-M-A-N. But Yeoman? Anybody have a better pronunciation? I'm from Milwaukee, so I don't know. You can also use that same generator to create your components and mixins. It just generates that basic required JS template. So it's a lot faster than typing that every time or copying it or using snippets or whatever. So that's it. Any questions? Wait.
Now, did you write this to learn Flyte?
No, what? I hope I do Flyte. No, this was more of a pain, but I always have to write my own presentation app in whatever language I'm talking on.
Jason, do you want to mention just like design and notify, right? It pretty quickly gets hard to reason about what's going to happen in the app when you do something. When you get a lot of
debugging becomes hard, yeah. The whole app gets immediately increased in complexity as soon as you start using events. But you're going to be way past that not using events, just using method calls. It does get tricky because there could be a lot of events firing for and multiple events, and the order can sometimes matter. But it's really the only way to do complicated UI things.
I don't know if you want to mention some of the things that we have done to map out the events. That's pretty helpful.
I haven't seen any of that.
Is that not helpful? Oh, you haven't seen that?
I mean,
Just a thing to go through.
Joe actually generated what every component triggered and listened to. I think it made a diagram of it. So
when you're really stuck, that's kind of helpful.
Yeah. Yeah, you can turn on the debug to see the triggers and step through them, but like I said, there could be a lot going on. So the best thing is to take the component out and just test it individually and see if it's working.
Yeah.